very warm welcome to St Mary's for our worship today. It's really good to be with you, and I'm going to hand over for our opening prayer.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning, Lord our God. As we welcome into your presence to worship you today, we thank you that we are enfolded in your loving arms. We welcome all who are watching and listening as we join together to honour and praise your name. Amen.
So we come to our words of confession. Lord God, forgive us for not welcoming others as you do, for looking askance at the stranger in our midst. We confess that we are too quick to note the differences between ourselves and others, but you treat all people the same. Forgive us for reveling in the presumed privilege of being your children. Help us to break down the barriers to you. Help us to unconditionally welcome all who would enter your walls and take your welcome wherever we would go. Amen. Heavenly Father, we thank you for welcoming us back into your presence, for pouring out your love and healing and reconciliation in our lives. Through the power of your Spirit at work, And may we, in our lives, share that forgiveness with those we encounter. In your name. Amen.
Jeremiah 31:31-34. The time is coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant I made with their forefathers when I took them by the hand and led them out of Egypt, because they broke my covenant, though I was a husband to them, declares the Lord. This is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after that time, declares the Lord. I will put my law in their minds and write it on their hearts. I will be their God, and they will be my people. No longer will a man teach his neighbour, or a man his brother, saying, Know the Lord, because they will all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, declares the Lord. For I will forgive their wickedness and will remember their sins no more.
The reading is taken from the Gospel according to St. John, chapter 12. Now there were some Greeks amongst those who went up to worship at the festival. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, with a request. Sir, they said, we would like to see Jesus. Philip went to tell Andrew. Andrew and Philip, in turn, told Jesus. Jesus replied, The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly, I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed. But if it dies, it produces many seeds. Anyone who loves their life will lose it, while anyone who hates their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, my servant also will be. My Father will honour the one who serves me. Now my soul is troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. No, it was for this very reason I came to this hour. Father, glorify your name. Then a voice came from heaven. I have glorified it and will glorify it again. The crowd that was there and heard it said it had thundered. Others said an angel had spoken to him. Jesus said, This voice was for your benefit, not mine. Now is the time for judgment on this world. Now the prince of this world will be driven out, and I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself. He said this to show the kind of death he was going to die. Here ends the lesson.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be always acceptable to you, O God, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Well, I wonder what the taboo subjects for you are. What are the things you just wouldn't dream of talking about with your neighbours, friends, parents, family? There's probably all sorts of things we would steer away from. Maybe it would be steering away from the talk of money or politics. Perhaps it might be relationships or friendships. There are lots of things that we say are taboo that we shouldn't talk about in polite society. Some people think that we shouldn't talk about faith in polite society. It's not exactly how Jesus sees it, but nonetheless, there are lots of things that are seen as taboo. And there's that great old traditional phrase that you shouldn't talk about religion or politics. And yet, actually, I think there are bigger taboo subjects that we avoid. And one of the most notable ones is that of death. We find it very difficult to talk about death. Of course we do. It's such a difficult subject. It's so hard to deal with, whether it be something that we're facing ourselves or whether it be that of a loved one. Because it cuts right to the very heart of who we are, our identity as human beings. And yet there is nothing so certain, we are told, as tax and death. I suspect when the Greeks went to see Jesus, they weren't expecting to hear him talk about death. They were expecting him to talk about life. They'd spoken to the disciples and had wanted to meet and encounter Jesus. And you can understand why. They'd heard the stories of him feeding 5,000 people with loaves and fishes. They'd heard of the miracles, the healings, the teachings. They'd heard of this man who brings new life and all these fascinating and crazy stories of people letting themselves down through roofs to be healed, of people begging Jesus for help and of him responding to help them. And so they were expecting to meet somebody who was going to talk, probably, I imagine, about life. There was no expectation. I wouldn't have thought about him talking about death. And yet, here we have, in John's Gospel, this conversation between the Greeks and Jesus that is exactly about the thing they're least expecting. Jesus says this, unless a grain of wheat falls to the earth and dies. Of course, he's preempting the thing that we know is going to happen over the next few weeks. He's preempting his arrest, his trial, the flogging, the crucifixion, and all of that. But at this point, the disciples, the friends, the Greeks, they don't know what's going to happen. They don't know that this story of death is going to be followed by a story of resurrection. And yet Jesus makes it very clear that actually he is going to die. And it is through his self-offering on the cross and through his death that that relationship between God and humanity is cemented, is reformed, is re-understood. It is the way in which forgiveness is expressed and love is shown in its wider sense, all embracing and holding us together. But it's also a timely reminder that those of us who follow Jesus will experience not just the life-affirming presence of God with us and the joy of being together in celebration, but the moments of sadness and difficulty. There will be moments of sacrifice, death, if you like, where we have to put something down in order to do something new. Unless a grain of wheat dies, unless that happens, there can't be new life. And that can be a very difficult thing in our own personal lives. It may be that we've got into a pattern of a relationship that's not good for us. And yet, we crave it. Or it might be that we found ourselves in a situation where our self-worth and identity comes from putting others down or talking about them unhelpfully. It may be that we have become obsessed with things rather than God and people, and we have to put those things down. If you like, we have to put them to death in order to bring life. As a Christian, it can be very tempting to skip over the death part and just jump to the resurrection. Just jump to the forgiveness, the wholeness, the joy of Easter Sunday, and miss out the bit in the middle, which actually is the bit that ultimately brings life. And as we journey through Holy Week in the next couple of weeks, perhaps we need to consider what it must have been like for Jesus as he gave up everything, including life, to bring God's purposes, to bring God's wholeness and forgiveness to the world. What is God calling us to put to death? What do we need to put aside? What do we need to put down? What do we need to face squarely? And in thinking about those things and praying about them, we do so knowing that unless the grain of wheat dies, unless that happens, there can't be new life. But of course, we still always hold in tension that great promise of new life through this moment of death. And that is the thing that gives us hope for our own lives and for those that we love. And so let's not avoid the subject. Let's be open and honest about it. Let's recognise that there are moments that God calls us to when we have to sacrifice and give over those things that we love in order to find true life in all its fullness. Amen.
I have heard so many songs, listened to a thousand tongues, but there is one that sounds above them all. The Father's song, the Father's love, you sung it over me. And for eternity, it's written on my heart. Heaven's perfect melody, the Creator's symphony. You are singing over me, the Father's song.
The response is, Lord, please show me how this applies in my life this week. Let us pray. Father Almighty, you have assured us through your word that you long to welcome everyone who would believe in Jesus. Through a baby in a manger and through a death on a cross, we thank you that you reached out to embrace all humanity. Help us to put aside our selfishness and pettiness in order to love and welcome others as you do. Open our eyes to see those who we don't know, to be mindful of strangers in our communities and our workplaces. Lord, please show me how this applies in my life this week. Guide our ears to hear voices that are seldom or never heard, to stand up for justice and social reform, or simply to take the time to listen more. Lord, please show me how this applies in my life this week. Grant us minds to understand the needs of other people, to humbly reflect not on our differences, but on how we need each other. Lord, please show me how this applies in my life this week. Warm our hearts to love all who we come into contact with. Break down our barriers and help us by your Holy Spirit to bring hope through the transforming life of Jesus. Lord, show me how this applies in my life this week and always. In Jesus' name, Amen. And we say together, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
And so as we come to the end of our service, we want to thank you for joining us for worship today. And to remind you that you can pick up the notices by sending us an email, stmarys.beverley@gmail.com, or do look at our website. There's lots and lots of information. You just have to go to www.stmarysbeverley.org. And we look forward to being in touch with you very soon. And so we come to our final hymn.
Thank you.
And so may God bless you and keep you. May he enable you to pick up your cross and follow Christ. And as you walk through each day of this Lenten time, may you know that Christ is with you, sustains you and holds you. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son and Holy Spirit be upon you and all whom you love and all whom you pray for, now and always. Amen.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, then I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who rules the nations with truth and justice? Shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life, then I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life, then I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.